15.15. The plastic ties forcing David Weir's hands behind his back cut into his flesh, the blood running slowly down his wrists and congealing on his sticky fingertips. The blindfold fastened around his eyes pressed against his eyeballs, threatening to burst them open like two small water balloons. But that was the least of his worries. When his captor forced him up the stairs, David had tripped and landed heavily on his right arm. Pain now washed over him in waves, threatening to blot out his senses. He was sure it was broken. Only the threat of the electric cattle prod got him back to his feet. After the climb up the 8 flights of stairs, they had eventually come to the top floor. Although blindfolded, David knew where he was. This was his floor, where he'd taught geography in the first classroom on the right for over 10 years. The one with the best view in Edinburgh, looking out to Holyrood Park and Arthur's Seat. It was the classroom where he'd dedicated his life to the children of Portobello High School, until the council decided to close the school and move them all to a more modern building not so very far away. Now the school was a shadow of its former self, abandoned, derelict, and awaiting demolition, which David knew only too well was scheduled for Friday afternoon. Was that today? A shove between the shoulder blades sent David staggering down the corridor, colliding with the wall, and releasing another wave of pain from his broken arm. He fell to his knees and breathed heavily, fighting the urge to vomit. If he did, the cloth his captor had thrust into his mouth would stop the contents of his stomach from going anywhere apart from back into his throat and down into his lungs. He would choke to death. David sensed his captor step around him, a waft of wind on his cheek as he passed. The rope which his captor had looped through his arms and the plastic ties connecting his wrists jerked him around, and he fell sideways onto the floor. Another wall of pain. Behind him, he heard a door being opened, feet clanging up a metal ladder, a few thumps and bangs, and then a breath of fresh air swept over him. It confused him. David knew what the sounds were and where the air came from. He'd expected his captor to lead him into his classroom. Why else would he have brought him up here? But instead, it seemed he'd opened the door to the supply cupboard, pulled down the ladder, and then forced open the hatch leading to the roof. In all his years of teaching, David had never actually been up there. It was too dangerous. His captor hauled him back onto his feet, pushed him forwards and into the cupboard. David banged against the ladder and tripped, falling again. His captor caught him, steadied him, and then bent down and lifted David's right foot up onto the first rung. Then his left. A prod to the back. Up. Climb. David coughed and tried for the 100th time to protest, but ended up once again fighting the urge to vomit. Instead, he succumbed to his captor's demands and started searching for the rungs with his feet, gingerly testing each one with his weight before committing himself to the next. Hurry. David almost missed the next step, but a hand forced his foot forwards and down until he found the right position. As David climbed, he sensed the walls around him disappear, and the wind began to buffet his head and shoulders. Somewhere close by, he could hear the sound of seagulls crying. The smell of the sea filled his nostrils. And there was something more, voices. David could hear voices. All the way up, his captor commanded him. David could feel the edge of the last rung against his ankle as he leant forward, but he was reluctant to step up above it, not knowing what was there. Step out onto the roof, his captor urged. Fighting the pain, his heart pounding, David complied, every nerve in his body flooding his brain with sensations as he tried to build a picture of where he now was and what was around him. He felt the crunch of gravel underfoot. The wind swirled around his legs and blew through his hair and against his cheeks. Fresh air. Salty. He heard footsteps below, coming up the ladder, and for a moment he felt relieved. Relieved that he wasn't going to be left up here all alone. A hand grabbed his arm, the broken one, and David almost passed out with the pain. His captor dragged him forward and yanked the gag out of his mouth. He felt an arm around his throat, grasping his head, and a hand forced his mouth open. Something was thrust into his mouth, a tablet, a capsule, then the lip of a bottle, and a liquid was squirted into his throat, forcing him to swallow, washing the tablet down into his stomach. Who are you? David choked and then gasped for air, his body trembling with fear. What did you just give me? Why are we here, on the roof? Why are you doing this to me? He felt the breath of his captor on the side of his face. The stench of garlic. Stale aftershave. Next, his captor's voice, loud, straight in his ear. It's only fair to let you know, it's nearly 4 o'clock. In less than 15 minutes, they're going to blow up the school. Good luck. Then the sound of footsteps as his captor moved away from him. Where are you going? David screamed, terrified. Don't leave me here. More silence. Then footsteps again, retreating. Where am I? How far from the edge? There was no reply. And then David felt very strange. His pulse was racing. He became confused. Dizzy. Weird. What was happening to him? Almost magically, the pain was ebbing away now, but it was replaced with a heightened sense of awareness and panic. Random thoughts began to rush through his head. Energy began to course through his veins. He was hot. Very hot. Sweat was running down his face, soaking his blindfold. He felt an overpowering need to move. Then in the distance, he heard the bang of the trapdoor being closed. The sound echoed and reverberated through his head. His captor had gone. David was now alone. Alone on top of the tallest building for miles around. A building due for demolition in the next few minutes. Escape. I have to escape. The thought entered his mind and then started to circulate, round and round. He heard the words being spoken to him, first by one voice, then by another. Soon a choir had taken up the chorus and was shouting the word in his mind, over and over again. Escape, escape, escape. His eyes had begun to twitch, his arms and legs jerking uncontrollably. David was growing increasingly frantic and scared, his heartbeat pounding rapidly in his ears. A rush of warmth down his legs told him he'd just pissed his pants with fear. David began to weep. Help! He heard himself cry, his voice weak, pathetic. Help! He shouted again, several times. But no one replied. With each second that passed, David could feel the drug taking even more effect. Agitated, unable to stand still, and heeding the advice in his head now screaming at him to escape, he started stumbling around the roof, searching for the trapdoor. At first, he moved cautiously, doing his best to sense the space in front of him before committing to it, petrified he could be near the edge of the building. But as the drug took more of a grip on him, his movements became more erratic. He was losing control. He had to hurry, and he had to find that trapdoor.